discussion. I haven't seen this either, so
right,
this
yes.
is
the first time.
Exciting for all of us in this room.
This picture then is not his, right?
Yes.
This is the old version.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes,
okay.
you're right, Dimitri.
You.
No, absolutely. And that's idealized, too.
Right.
Well, I can see that. Yeah, well, thank you, Elena. That was a good introduction, actually. Now you've covered some things that I don't have to mention about why we did this project. And also, I'm really happy this morning because now I realize I'm not the only one who still has questions that we don't know the answer to. I'm really afraid of being that one person. But as you all know, the ship was originally reconstructed by Mr. Steffi. And you see him, of course, here working on it. And as Lena mentioned, the problem is that over time, his ideas about it changed. His ideas continued to develop right up until the time of his death. And in fact, shortly before, he came to realize that in fact, the hole is probably not as deep in the original reconstruction as it should have been. So that was one of the reasons why we were brought in to do this. From his original reconstruction in the early 1970s, he was able to publish the lines drawing, which those of you who are familiar with maritime matters know that essentially what a lines drawing is, it's the traditional way you do a plan of a ship in naval architecture back in the days before we had computers. And so what it gives you is a two-dimensional drawing of the three-dimensional shape of the hull. So you're talking about switching then a three-dimensional object into a two-dimensional object here for graphing purposes. So you're already getting into a difficulty of visualization with this sort of thing. If you try to take something like this and think about how the ship was actually shaped, it's harder to wrap your mind around it, even if you're trained in drafting. But even so, it's harder to wrap your mind around it. This was his original lines drawing right here. This was published in 1985 in his American Journal of Archaeology article, and then in his book in 1994. And it's the original one in which it was based. And this is the one which has the height up to the originally reconstructed height right here, which now we think is not really high enough as it should be. But that was his original reconstruction. And of course, based on this, you also had replicas built. The smaller sailing replica, I think that's 1:5 scale.
Yes,
1:5 scale. And then of course, Kyrenia 2, and now Kyrenia Liberty. And it was with these reconstructions of Mr. Steffi's work that was one of the things that made him start to realize that in fact the hull shape probably needed to be higher, because this is the picture of Liberty loaded up with the replica cargo, and you can see how it's overflowing, and also I believe it floated very low in the water.
It nearly sank.
There was not much free board.
And fill the top. And also this splayed out configuration we've learned is not the right way. They should each be vertical.
Right. So the stacking here is not so great. But either way, if you put all these amphoras aboard, you're ending up with a very dangerously low freeboard. And again, you can say, well, what was the idea of danger to the ancient Greeks? But sailors are, I don't think, in any time period, going to go to sea in a ship that they know is that low and going to sink.
Were the belt stops in there too?
Yeah, they're
down underneath.
Yeah. Yeah. So you can visualize how hard it would be to see the millstone.
Yeah, that's a good. Andrea, you couldn't see them. You made the point.
This is the second ship in the first place.
Right, well, if you had it loaded like this, you can see why the ship would have gone down. But it wouldn't make a whole lot of sense to load it like this, as you being a sailor know, that you wouldn't want to do that sort of thing. So Mr. Steffi had, not long before his death, come up with a new idea about how deep the shape of the hull would have been, and he modified his original line drawing. So the one on the bottom is a later version that you can see is now higher up than the one at the top. Several additional strakes would be needed. And the other question, dealing with this is, if you notice up here at the bow on both of these, you see how much you have that great curvature upward right at the bow. The bow is on the left-hand side here. The question originally in his publications, he wrote that he thought that that was original. It looks odd to those of us who study ships. That a curvature like that looks very strange. It's always looked strange to me. But in his original 1985 article, he talks about this some, and because of the evidence at that time, he believed that that was part of the way the ship actually was designed that way. He came later on to believe that, in fact, the keel was more likely flatter, that this was probably caused by formation processes and for the 2,000 years the ship spent underwater, and therefore this was probably not such a great rise upward, and we needed to flatten this back out some here. So he never got a chance to really do that. One of the things I don't know, we can discuss this, is why he really came to think that. I don't really quite understand that, but we'll talk about that later on. So where do we come in? I'm at East Carolina University. We are one of the three maritime archaeology graduate programs in the country, along with Texas A&M and West Florida. A few scattered people here and there, but we're one of the three major programs in this. And I have been doing a number of work with Fred Hocker, who was my professor, and Fred was Mr. Steffi's main protege, or main student, when Mr. Steffi was teaching at Texas A&M. And then I took classes with Fred. I was one of his grad students when I was at Texas A&M. And Fred is now the head of research at the Vasa Museum in Sweden. Vasa, they don't have these problems that we have, because although they have a lot bigger ship, they have almost all of it. So they're not worrying about trying to reconstruct what's not there, like we are. But Fred had been using these total station points. Essentially, you see Fred right there with a total station. It's just, those of you in archaeology are familiar with this, we use it for making maps of sites, but we can also use it to record the shapes of hulls. And it's very good for this sort of thing, because the traditional ways you used to record hulls were simply doing them like we do archaeology in other areas. You put down flat planes and you do grid-type squares. Well, the problem with that with ships especially is that ships are so curved. There are very few straight lines on the hull of a ship. And so what you really need to get that the most accurately is you need some type of three-dimensional recording system. And so Fred had been working with this on Vasa. He has the ship and needed to record it. I have a bunch of grad students who needed to learn how to do things, and so it was a perfect partnership. We started going and working with Fred in Sweden to do these sort of things. And then after that, Susan had found out what Fred was doing here and contacted me. And he suggested Susan contact me about bringing some students over there to work on this and to do this three-dimensional recording of the Kyrenia ship as it currently sits in the museum right now. For all of these reasons, because we have these unanswered questions that were left over from Mr. Steffi's work, and also because of the very real possibility that the entire gallery could, in fact, come down. I hope that is. Obviously, we all hope that does not happen, but it's possible that sort of thing could happen, and we wanted to get an accurate recording of it beforehand. So you can see here, these were the goals that we had. Essentially, our goal was to go and conduct a complete recording of it, so we have everything, and then to use that to test these ideas that Mr. Steffi had come up with. Specifically, things such as how high up did the ship really need to be in order to float properly and safely, and also what about this idea of the bow? Should it be tilted upward at this great angle or not? So I went there seems a long time ago now, in the spring of 2011. A lot of intervening things have happened in between, but I went there with a team of some of my students and colleagues from East Carolina, and we spent about 2 weeks there in the spring recording this, and this is you can see at the end. The reason we're all smiling in this one is because this is the end. We had just finished at this point, so we know we've got the data. We're not great. And as with any of these kind of things, dealing with computers, you have to worry about what your equipment's going to do. We managed to do it. I know time is short. I just wanted to mention these guys because without them, we would not have had a project. And I wish Robin had been here. It was a great joy to me to get to meet Lena and work with her as well. But Robin and I had worked together years ago in Turkey on other excavations, Ulverin and Bozburin. So it was a wonderful joy to work with Robin Piercy again. I wish he could be here. And Robin got these guys to set up, and they were the ones that really saved our project, because in order to do recording with a total station, you have to have it perfectly level and perfectly still, and it has to stay that way all the time. And how do you do that recording a Kyrenia ship? That was the issue. So I think, as you know, those of you who, well, everybody knows this, it's on a podium, and so it's raised up off the floor. So we had to get something high enough to enable us to shoot down back into it. And the only way to do that was to build scaffolding around it, so that's where these guys came in. Robin is, I never worried about it. I just let Robin know we needed something like this. And I knew from working with him in Turkey years ago that he'd find a way to get it done. That's what he's a genius at. And so he got these guys to bring in scaffolding and set it up, and they were used to doing it for buildings, so for that you need to be able to walk around on it, but that doesn't have to be perfectly still. So they had to modify it. It took a while for him to explain it to them and all that, but we got it done. We got it still enough so that you could shoot. This is Calvin Myers, one of my colleagues up there shooting the points with the total station there. It was a little unsteady at times. You'd have to kind of aim your point and then stay as still as possible while making the shot. So that did lead some issues in data. Accessibility to the ship. You have to be able to point out exactly where your shot is going to go. And so, again, we've used Robin's gantry that he had designed and built way back when as well for this. There's one of our students working on it. And the good thing about Kyrenia, as opposed to Vasa, is that it gives you lots of little remaining places where you can actually get in there and record the data. And I recommend that anytime you're doing an archaeology project, have a mix of big and small people on your project. I usually have a small cover. But we had Chelsea here as well, who was quite petite, and she was able to get up underneath and stick her head up and point out various areas right there where we needed to shoot. So a couple weeks of shooting, and we ended up with a collection of raw data that looks right like this right here. This is what you get when you're done. It's a point cloud. And what it is, all of the different colors are different features on it. The coding system we use, we try to shoot different types of timbers with a different color and a layer so that when we bring it into our computer drafting program, it's a lot easier to deal with. This was the raw data. And even just in this, you can see, from the isometric view, you can see you've got a good understanding right there of what the shape of the ship is. And you can see all the different things. That big red blob right there is Wendy's big old anchor. She had us. She snuck in and managed to get us to do work for her while she was there as well. So what I've been doing over the last 4 years, and it's tearing my hair out, that's why I got my hair cut off short so I don't have to tear it out anymore.
Just turned a bit gray, didn't it?
Yeah, quite a bit, yeah. It's trying to figure out how to take this and reconcile it to what Mr. Steffi had already produced. And I assumed all along that it was essentially going to match up pretty much. Unfortunately, it turned out not to be the case, and this is the big monkey wrench that I have to throw into what we're doing here, is that it turns out that the ship, as it's sitting in the museum right now, is actually quite a bit different than his drawings show it to be. It doesn't match real well at all. It's shorter, it's wider. I'll show you what I mean. But this is what I've been doing, is reconstructing the lines, again, based on the training that I have with Fred Hocker that he got from Mr. Steffens. About 25 centimeters. So this, essentially what I'm doing is every one of these places is a section line where I've reconstructed the shape of it based on the known planking that we have, and then doing a reconstruction up above that, just like Mr. Steffi did originally, put the thing back together. And it takes a long time to do this process, because every time you change something, you realize something's wrong, it affects everything else. And so you have to go back and work on it.
How did you do these? Did you take these from the outside of the hall and then subtract them? Thinking
no.
Or directly from the measurement you took on the inside?
This is the inside. We shot everything that we could think of to shoot, and we had time to shoot. And I knew going into it that because the hull shape was going to be critical, we needed to get the shapes of the frames themselves, but it's a shell-based vessel, the ancient Greek ship, so frames were added later on. So we also shot on the inside the runs of the planking. We have the outside, too. But the inside's better for it because the outside, as you know, is so much more rough. Mm-hmm. The inside planking generally is better. Get better lines off of it. But essentially, this is what my reconstruction looks like in sections.
So how would you shoot underneath the outside anyway from up there?
Well, we didn't. By that, we went on around the edges and shot back up at it. So
you have to get down below to shoot up?
Yeah. When you're doing this, you have numerous stations all around. And that's why, actually, you see in this, you see all these little yellow dots that are outside the ship. All those represent a place where you have this, either the station set up or a data point set up to work on.
That's a lot of work.
I also shot the gallery around it, too. On that last day when we were trying to get everything done there, we shot everything we could think of to shoot in. In the interest that even if it didn't...
Well, if I have to reconstruct the...
Yeah, whole thing. Right. Well, I have the gallery, so that's
good.
You got
distances,
axes from the distance to the ship as well, so...
Yeah, we've got the actual space in the...
You got a 3D printer, you can just put the whole thing on.
Yeah. One of these days, and here, if you put a surface on that, the program I'm using is a computer-aided design program called Rhinoceros, which is essentially it's a drafting program. It's kind of like AutoCAD, if you're familiar with that, except that to those of us who are not specialists in this, it's a lot easier and more intuitive to learn and use than AutoCAD is. But it allows you to take these shapes and then put surfaces on them. So the light green there represents my interpretation of what the shape of the hull is, which I've been working on now for quite a long time and changed my mind on many times. And the problem with it is, as I mentioned, it differs quite a bit from what Mr. Steffi shows the shape of the hull being. For example, right here, this is the midship section, which when we're looking at ships and the ship design and shape, one of the key things that we want to look at is the midship section. The midships is, by definition, the widest point of the hull. And if you look at this one, the one in red is what Mr. Steffi's drawings. And for this, I simply took his drawings digitize. You can bring in the drawings into the computer, scale them appropriately, and then digitize those. So I've digitized Mr. Steffi's drawings, and you can see here, that in red is what his midship section shape looks like, and in blue is what I get when I actually do my line reconstruction of it right here. So you can see how much it differs there. It's about 12 centimeters wider, and that's on one side, so if you double it, that means the hull is about 24 centimeters wider midships than we thought.
Can you interpret this as also sagging?
Well, that's one of the questions. And we've talked about that, Lena and Robin and I, and we can go into it some more here. I don't know how much it is.
I mean, I would just think that the sole process of constructing the outside mold, you're getting away from the original drawings right off the bat there. Then you're taking the planks, you're putting the planks up, they've got a certain amount of weight, you're adjusting the outside support to support them. That during this whole process, it seems to me, gravity is going to work against you, and it's going to create a sag.
It is, but I'm not sure it would do it this much, and Robin is of the opinion that it hasn't as much in here. He's been there over the last year.
But Robin is the one who's been testing this and also testing the metal frame, and he does think now that there's a bit of sagging in the metal frame that he constructed to hold the sides of the ship.
It's natural.
It's got kind of a basket.
Gravity's your enemy. Yeah.
It's like a basket cradle of steel beams, steel bars that run down the length of it, but then those are supported on stanchions that are vertical. So, that makes it better. That makes me feel better, actually, if that's the case. Even though that means now we have to figure out what to do with how to reconcile these.
Yeah, and the other thing we also realized, and all of us have been guilty of doing this, getting up onto the podium to look at the ship. What do you take a hold of? You take a hold of the vertical support to pull yourself up.
But still, I'm still surprised that it does it so consistently. See, that's the thing that makes me think
consistency.
Yeah, I would think that you'd find it then.
Sure.
Yeah. You think it would be in points, but not all three. That's the problem.
So we're looking at other sections. Do you get the same sort of?
Yeah. So that's the problem. That's the issue. There's midships right there. That's the difference in midships.
Well, since when you look at it, would be justified that it goes evenly everywhere.
Yeah. See, I wouldn't expect it to sag evenly.
But when the deep drawer is lined. After he put the hull together in the gallery, because even like what he put in the gallery, in a sense, is his reimplementation and the iron or whatever they are, steel framework is his interpretation well. So from that point of view, like the stone station data, if it hasn't sagged, may also reflect just that interpretation as he was putting it together, which may not be the same as it
was.
Right.
And that's a question I have on my list of things.
Yeah, but the metal frame was put in initially, it was all wood.
Right.
And then the metal frame was put in once it was reconstructed.
But the thing is, the whole reason he's able to...
So the wood reproduced the original line.
Yes.
Yes.
Yeah.
You reconstructed it.
I was not there, but from the photographs and what Robin said, it was all there was wooden stanchioning. All around, and
which
then
the
metal frame was put in.
All of that allows for.
Should we call it sagging? What
sagging?
For gravity.
It does, but the thing is that you're gonna see it. I'm still surprised that we do it so consistently.
So in other words, this could be a systematic error.
It could be,
and not simply fortuitous uniform sagging.
Right. It could be. But again, just knowing, the big question I don't know is when did Mr. Stephanie make the lines exactly? My understanding is he made them, his reconstruction, he's putting together the reconstruction, and when he's finished with that, he then draws up the lines from it. That's the way I think it happened, as far as I can tell.
He dates his drawings, so
just
check the drawings.
Right, and that's why I think that, just from talking to Robin. Still, you can see here it's clearly like that, because here the blue points here are the total station data points. You see how they fit the way I'm putting it here. They don't fit what his is right there, and it's something we're going to have to figure out how to reconcile these two sets of data. And I don't know yet the answer to how to do it. But I'd be here to talk about this. But it also comes into play, of course, with this question about what's going on in that aft cabin from F6 aft, because this is what. Under my interpretation, you get at F6. The red, again, is Mr. Steffi's. In this case, the light green is mine. At F6, you're talking about a difference of 20 centimeters there, which would be 40 centimeters. We're talking almost a half a meter wider here is what we're seeing today.
And that's the position where the cabin wall.
Exactly. That's why I put this one up here as an example.
Air for
a
So it's basically an air for a width.
Yeah, I guess so.
That's it.
They use
the cargo,
so
we
make
the ship
right.
He measures everything.
Do you evaluate them in
Emperor
heights?
I evaluate them in decibels.
I should mention on here, these, all of the reconstructed heights here are to the highest.
It takes volumetric measurements, too.
The other thing...
When you say higher height, maybe I jumped on. Like when you say higher height, did you grab Mr. Stephanie's drawings where he did the 60 centimeters or 1 meter higher?
I have.
Did you add to it?
The one that I showed up there earlier, which was the latest one that I have.
And is that a meter or 60 centimeters?
I don't know.
Okay.
Sure. I think it's only like 60.
Okay.
I believe it was like 60. It looks about like 60. Yeah. So that's what that one is. That's directly what this is based on. The other issue, a couple of other issues with it, and this one I don't think we can get into because of sagging, whether you might argue me around if the thing is sagged some. But this is the one where it's the real big one, which is that the ship is actually not quite as long as he has it as well. Although, in his published 85 AJA article, he gives the length of the keel at 9.33 meters. With the total station, I'm measuring it out to be 9.25, which is close enough that you can figure a little bit of shrinkage, different measuring, tape measure versus a more precise instrument, 40 years. That one I'm happy that we're in the same ballpark.
But it also depends on how we laid out the keel when he put it together, because if he left more spaces between the sections that are broken, or
right.
he adds 1 centimeter between one section as he laid it out in the gallery,
right.
His is larger versus smaller.
Yes, his is larger.
Yeah.
So
yeah,
his is larger.
The planking would have acted as a control on the length of the keel.
Yeah, exactly. So he's got the keel length at being about that, and again, I get about 9.25 with the total station. So it's within a range that I consider fine because the difference is there. But what that means then is when you look at the shape of these and you put them down, the ship is not as long. So this right here at the end, this is the stern post at that side. You can see the dark blue, the brown there. That's where his length would be. His length of keel is coming back in here. I would end the keel right here. Well, we have it. Since we have both ends of the keel shot with the total station, I know how long starts. And so this is where I would have the end of planking, and that right there would be my start. So it's about 25 centimeters shorter than he's showing it on his drawings.
So 25 centimeters wider and 25 centimeters shorter?
More or less. Well, if depending on the sagging, but the length, I think, is there. And I think part of... Yeah, and the other issue that goes with this is somewhere, one way or another, there's a mismeasurement in here somewhere that got put into the drawing. And talking with this with Jeff Royal, we think we figured out how it happened, how something like this might have happened. He might have simply, when he was getting ready to do his drawing, he'd taken his measurement of the keel length, scaled it down, calculated out what his length should be when he drew it, and instead of drawing it to, say, 46 centimeters minus 3.5 millimeters, he went to 46 centimeters plus 3.5 millimeters. This is what we think might well have happened on this, and why his keel length ended up being too long on the drawings, longer than it should be.
And he scaled everything down by hand.
Jeff Royal was, I hadn't figured out that this had definitely happened. And then the next week, Jeff was visiting to talk to our class, one of my classes, and he and I were talking about it, and Jeff's light bulb went on in Jeff's head. And he went and got a ruler, and he was looking, if you had it, if he was going to do at 46 minus 0.35, and when he went to then draw it, if he went plus 0.35, it gives you basically the exact amount that he's over. The next week, Fred Hawker was visiting in town for thesis defenses. And I mentioned this to him, and he said, I know how Mr. Stephanie laid out his drawings, and that's almost certainly what happened. So he thinks that's what happened, too. Again, we can never prove this for sure, but something happened, and the drawing's too long on the keel, no matter what. No matter what you do with the sagging issue. And the other thing with that is that it also affects the position of the midship section, that widest point of the hull, which has an effect then on how something is going to handle in the water, sailing, depending on where you put your sail. So on this one, here, the red line is where Mr. Steffi is showing the midship section. Again, this is digitized directly from his drawing. This is the forward end of the keel. That's where he has the midship section. In reality, from the forward end of the keel to F-25, midship section is right there, the blue line. It's 0.39 meters, 39 centimeters farther aft of where he has it on his. And that's not due to sagging or anything like that. that in that case. We're talking about something entirely different here. So what you get then, if you look at Mr. Steffi's original one, you've got a situation where the widest point of the ship is slightly forward of the longitudinal center point of the ship, which is more typical of the shape in a sailing vessel. In reality, though, if you reconstruct the bow length, the stem length, because again, we don't have this up here anymore, so we don't know how far that goes is the reconstruction. If you reconstruct it to his total length, but put the midships here, it moves the midships aft of the longitudinal center point of the ship. Those of you who know more about sailing design and how ships are going to handle your sail probably tell more than I can about that. But to me, just what I know about this sort of thing, I think that's going to have an effect on how something is going to sail. So the question.
Wait, sorry, Eric.
Yeah.
That is the bow.
This ends the bow.
Yes. It has sort of a projected depth.
Yeah.
I thought before you had it up, and you talked about the stern being too.
No, the bow is too high.
The bow is too high.
The bow is, okay. I think, is tilted up too much at this angle right here. Yeah, yes.
In that diagram, can you indicate where the mast is set?
I can put it on there. I'll have to go back and turn
it. That affects very much some of this handling equipment.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I think.
Yeah. And the mast step has two different positions.
Right, I can imagine that also, yeah.
I only noticed this yesterday, the other day when I was putting this presentation together, that the midships was that far different.
It's all mooted with that. The mast step is in front of both those lines.
It is.
It is.
Yes, it is. Oh, well in front.
It's yeah,
not, well,
I don't think it's that's 25 and it's at 40.
I don't think that, but really it's the center of effort of the sail that matters,
yeah.
And it's right, and that's variable depending on how the sail is manipulated, but it's always going to be far forward of the mast.
It is, but it's also the center of effort relating to the center of lateral resistance of the hull.
Sure.
And the center of lateral resistance of the hull is going to be different in a shape like this.
None of that was measured anyway for the sailing performance,
okay.
So it's not graphable, unfortunately.
Right. Yeah. So again, you know, we can figure out what the differences are here. But this brings up the question in my mind, is the hull shape really like this? And there's no reason you can't make a shape like this. It's just different than what sailing ships are typically shaped like. So does that mean then that the bow is actually reconstructed too long, that it should not go quite this far forward? We know the keel is indefinite. We have both ends of the keel, so we know how long that is. That's no problem. But up here at the stem, it's a two-piece stem, and up here it breaks off in this area here. We don't have anything further forward. So everything from there forward is a reconstructed shape based on, length based on the way that the planking, surviving planking, is going in.
And we've got that very problematic scarf that
yeah.
is the junction between the keel and the two pieces of the stem post,
yeah.
which was a weak point, and
right.
I think that helped the ship sink.
Yeah, and I will say that having done a lot of time trying to reconstruct now the shape of the ship, the part that I've had the most difficulty with is up there in the bow.
And that's where Dick had the most.
I know, and I can see why. And no matter, and yeah, he used to talk to Aristides. I talk to Mr. Steffi now. So I'm talking to him. And
you read in his notebooks, because
yeah.
he kept stenographer's notebooks, and you read, and he would say, I put the bow together on Tuesday. Wednesday, I went back to the bow and took it all apart and put it back together again on Thursday.
Right.
And it was so poorly preserved and worm-eaten
yeah.
in the bow, had that second layer of wooden sheathing as well to try and protect the bow and keep the ship afloat,
yeah.
that it was a very problematic area for him.
No matter what, I've had to ferret that area out more than anything else in the hull. In other words, there's plenty of places where I have point data from my total station where I've shot it, where it just doesn't, no matter what I do with it, I can't get it to work together, all of it fit together and make the right shape. So I've had to ignore places up there.
Look at the finesse that I'm sorting out that are loose on the seabed, and there are a good 750 that were outside the construction. And if you look at the numbers of them that are found on those sides around the vessel, you would be able to add straight up to 60 centimeters. So that's definitely.
And you're comfortable with that, Wendy, that the pattern you've been able to establish. The patterning changes because with these two different phases of construction, with the lower sided hull, the mast step was turned around the other way. This is what Dick has always said, with the, then somebody got the bright idea that let's turn this smaller, narrower, let's say, not so bulky ship into a bulk amphora carrier, which is really very interesting, Bill, for you and the economics of the time period. But they used a different method of construction that I think Wendy and I feel quite comfortable with, that these top timbers that were added, one, they were recycled. They were all almost, well, I think all of them, from other ships, because they don't fit.
That's the frames you're talking about?
The frames. The top timbers, which are the frames that go up higher, that a lot of shims and wedges had to be used for the addition of these top timbers. And also, it would seem that they may have been attached, first of all, with tree nails. And then Wendy's clinch nails were put in higher up. Now, this is not always the case, but we have evidence for this. And we don't know whether frame six, where the bulkhead was placed, was in the original ship in that position. We know there's a bulkhead there, because Dan asked me this question, and that's why it's on the list, because there are mortise and tenons in the top surface of frame six. And Mr. Steffi thought only on the port side, but we have found over the years now, with Wendy looking in Pembe the cleaner, cleaning, wonderful cleaning young lady, that the mortise and tenons are also on the starboard side. And frame six was added in. It goes against the patterning of floor, buttock, and half frame. So it was an addition. But we do not know for sure whether that was on the first ship.
Frame six in the stern.
Better on the port side. There it is there.
We're also, because we went through the manuscript, reading it by my line and checking it on the hull, as it is today on display, we realized that Dick, and he couldn't have had anything else. He depended so heavily on the tracings that he put the ship together in the early 70s, and then after that he would have gone back to check it, those tracings and everything against the hull, but he never had that opportunity because the Cypriot War broke out, and by the time he could, he wasn't physically able anymore to double check everything he did. And then of course in the meantime things have shrunk a lot, so we found all sorts of new things that are not visible in the one-to-one tracings that were made. The ship was raised, and you see that the ship definitely has changed.
And you should mention, because again, when we're talking about where goods came from, the nails that were found, there's no metal left in the nails in the hull. Isn't that true, Wendy?
Yes.
But spare nails carried in the after cabin, encapsulated in the big, wonderful big concretion, are made from Cypriot copper. And the copper comes from the Limni mines, which is near Polis in the western part, and also two mines, fingerprints to two different sets of mines in Larnaca and Limassol on the east coast.
Oh, can I just, so that's fantastic that we have that information, although, of course, copper from Cyprus was one of the most highly sought after products that was used. It was acquired on its own, and it was put into other materials, and those materials would have been items of, if you need a ready store of nails, any port in the Aegean probably would have had some that had Cypriot.
Exactly. But my point of saying this, it doesn't mean that the ship was built with Cyprus.
Yeah.
But there is Cypriot copper there, which is nice and reassuring. A lot of recycled materials, a lot of attempts to keep the ship going, meaning there are replacement straits, which is extremely difficult, in particular in the bow, this weak area of the bow, very hard to put replacement repair straits in the shell first construction, but these shipbuilders figured out how to do it. When the masthead was turned around to the position that it's in when the ship sank, the floor of frame 40, if you could point it out, was cut to make a bilge sump, So it means that the weighting of the hull had changed, and the lowest point was there at 40, and they needed a sump cut so they could get the water out. There were internal lead patches in the bow all over the place, on seams, over seams, between strakes, but also within strakes themselves. So obviously there was a lot of stress and strain in the bow, and the wood was suffering. Teredo worm had gotten into the strakes in the bow. We will never be able to know exactly how much. It was that second layer of sheathing put on the exterior of the hull. And then the last thing to be done was to cover the entire preserved hull that we have in the seabed with a thin layer of lead sheathing. And that lead, all the lead that we have on the ship comes from Lavrion. Sophie Gale has analyzed it, and I think all of it's from Labrador, isn't it?
I think so.
But that makes sense because Labrador was the byproduct of the silver mining.
Copper for Cyprus, basically.
Yes, exactly.
But we have, I think, one copper nail that fingerprints with Labrador as well. But there's something weird there. The problem is, as Lena said, we can't test, even though we have the nails in the hull, and they're all on that particular plan, each one of them that we drilled is nothing but a hull of concretion. Whereas all the nails in the nail sack, they have still metallic copper in them. But that's only a handful or a bunch.
But it's better than nothing.
Right, that's right.
And they were probably there to be used on the ship in case of emergency. As I think you all know, most of the hull is, if we go with Nelly Lipschitz's analyses, and she has analyzed over 400 wood samples. Every strake has been sampled, even whether the scarfs, you know, the front of the scarf and after the scarf. She says that the hull is Pinus brutia. There is some Cedrus libani, cedar of Lebanon. For one of the frames is Cedrus libani, and the
is that this one layer 25?
Yeah.
Not that one. Only the top, dead out where your finger is. Not that section. That's Pinus brutia. That section.
And then also the. The knee for the stern post is Cedrus libani.
Yeah.
I think we have one frame at least that's poplar. It's interesting that poplar is being used.
That's 49.
And I don't think we have an oak frame.
Frame of opportunity. Yeah, we do. Number 37.
It's oak. And the steering oar, which we have the starboard steering oar, which Dan Davis is going to be studying, we hope, more fully. That is a pine. There have been some pieces of wood found in the big concretion that are of ash, which we'd like to see be part of the tiller. Definitely it's not the loom for the steering, or we don't have anything big enough. Then we have one piece, well actually two fragments of what we think may be the yard. It's UM99. It'll be on the drawing, the front drawing there. It's down close to the starboard side, the starboard portion of the hull. It has a copper band around it, which turns into double rings. There are two pieces. It is made of ash. The second piece, which Mr. Steffi forgot about in the publication, I was poking around in it a couple of years ago, and found that it has a mortise and a tenon in it. And this could be evidence to attach a fair lead on the top of the yard, if indeed it is part of the yard. So that is quite exciting news, but...
And it's found right beside a cauldron, copper cauldron, right next to it. So it's tucked in.
So how does that work? A mortise and tenon to attach a fair lead, which would be a ring.
Well,
it's about a
wooden fairly, so it would have a little arch in it, like
yes.
This. So it would be attached more as a tenon on the other side.
And the fragment isn't big enough to have the second tenon, if indeed.
So it's just the what would you call it, the trace of the whatever the attached part was, or is that all?
We don't have the attached part. We just have the attachment for something.
So the mortise is cut. There's a tenon in it.
The mortise is cut down into the ovoid,
the ash
into the piece of ash. It happens that it's right at the break, and the mortise goes down about that far, and there is the fragment of the tendon which is shaped with the characteristic bottom end like this in it, and there's half a fake hole for attaching into something.
Yeah. Into the
fair lead of whatever may have been there.
Would you think, just on the side, would you think that, is that going to take pressure? It's going to take pressure, right?
Not that much.
Not much?
No, because the pressure is diverted downward.
Yeah.
Right, so if you've got
a line going up,
it's always going to be pulling it down anyway.
Yes, it is, but yeah. my point is that up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down, over some fair lead.
Yeah, there's going to be some, that's why you do mortise and tenon.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, so you can replace it.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting idea.
Yeah. And the two rings, instead of having a parallel that would hold the yarn to the mast, you'd have two rings that spring off of that fitting.
Yeah, amazing.
That would simply be roped around the mast. So in other words, you don't have the leather gasket that they use on K2 and
Liberty.
You have something a bit more fixed than that.
Maybe it's time to move on to another.
Yeah, definitely. What other ones do we want to discuss in here? Because we've got navigation, sailing, we've covered the bulkhead, we've covered the repairs and the final lead sheathing, covered the heightening of the ship. But Dan, I think maybe if you could tell us some things about what you have been working with Glafos, with Kyrenia too. But
I made some handouts, I'll pass those around. Unfortunately, I don't have enough for everybody. I want to blame my student for the copying snafu, but I think I'll blame my student for it. I'm not saying it was his fault, but it was his fault.
Can you send an argument and we have a
student? I could have.
Where's our student?
Yeah.
We don't have a student.
This has, I threw a little bit of everything into this handout going around.
We can get more from it.
Yeah.
Sorting out that are loose on the seabed, and there are a good 750 that were outside the construction. And if you look at the numbers of them that are found on those sites around the peninsula, you would be able to add straight up to 60 centimeters. So that's definitely.
And you're comfortable with that, Wendy? That the pattern you've been able to establish the pattern is 75%
at the moment. Yeah.
The patterning changes because with these two different phases of construction, with the lower-sided hull, the mast step was turned around the other way. This is what Dick has always said. With then somebody got the bright idea that let's turn this smaller, narrower, let's say, not so bulky ship into a bulk amphora carrier, which is really very interesting, Bill, for you and the economics of the time period. But they used a different method of construction that I think Wendy and I feel quite comfortable with, that these top timbers that were added, one, they were recycled. They were all of them, from other ships, because they don't fit.
That's the frames you're talking about?
The frames. The top timbers, which are the frames that go up higher, that a lot of shims and wedges had to be used for the addition of these top timbers. And also it would seem that they may have been attached, first of all, with tree nails. And then Wendy's clinch nails were put in higher up. Now this is not always the case, but we have evidence for this. And we don't know whether frame 6, where the bulkhead was placed, was in the original ship in that position. We know there's a bulkhead there, because Dan asked me this question, and that's why it's on the list. because there are mortise and tenons in the top surface of frame 6. And Mr. Steffi thought only on the port side, but we have found over the years now, with Wendy looking and Pembe the cleaner, cleaning, wonderful cleaning young lady, that the mortise and tenons are also on the starboard side. And frame 6 was added in. It goes against the patterning of floor, buttock, and half frame. So it was an addition. But we do not know for sure whether that was on the first ship or not.
Frame 6 in the stern, yeah.
Frame 6 in the stern, yeah. Yeah, better on the port side. There it is there.
We're also, because we went through the manuscript, reading a diamond line and checking it on the hull, as it is today on display, we realized that Dick, and he couldn't have had anything else. He depended so heavily on the tracings that he put the ship together in the early 70s, and then after that he would have gone back to check it, those tracings and everything against the hull. But he never had that opportunity because the Cypriot War broke out. And by the time he could, he wasn't physically able anymore to double-check everything he did. And then, of course, in the meantime, things have shrunk a lot. So we found all sorts of new things that are not visible in the one-to-one tracings that were made after the ship was raised. And you see that the ship definitely has changed.
And you should mention, because again, when we're talking about where goods came from, the nails that were found, there's no metal left in the nails in the hull. Isn't that true, Wendy?
Yes.
But spare nails carried in the after cabin, encapsulated in the big, wonderful big concretion, are made from Cypriot copper. And the copper comes from the Limni mines, which is near Polis in the western part, and also two mines, fingerprints to two different sets of mines in Monaco and Limassol on the east coast.
Oh, can I just, so that's fantastic that we have that information, although, of course, copper from Cyprus was one of the most highly sought after products that was used. It was acquired on its own and it was put into other materials, and those materials would have been items of, if you need a ready store of nails, any port in the Aegean probably would have had some that had Cypriot.
Exactly. But my point of saying this, it doesn't mean that the ship was built from Cyprus.
Yeah.
But there is Cypriot copper there, which is nice and reassuring. A lot of recycled materials. A lot of attempts to keep the ship going, meaning there are replacement straits, which is extremely difficult, in particular in the bow, this weak area of the bow. Very hard to put replacement repair straits in the shell-first construction, but these shipbuilders figured out how to do it. When the mast step was turned around to the position that it's in when the ship sank, the floor of frame 40, if you could point it out, was cut to make a bilge sump. So it means that the weighting of the hull had changed and the lowest point was there at 40, and they needed a sump cut so they could get the water out. There are internal lead patches in the bow all over the place, on seams, over seams, between strakes, but also within strakes themselves. So obviously there was a lot of stress and strain in the bow and the wood was suffering. Teredo worm had gotten into the strakes in the bow. We will never be able to know exactly how much. It was that second layer of sheathing put on the exterior of the hull. And then the last thing to be done was to cover the entire preserved hull that we have in the seabed with a thin layer of lead sheathing. And that lead, all the lead that we have on the ship comes from Lavrion. Sophie Gale has analyzed it, and I think all of it's from Lavrion, isn't it?
I think so. I'm pretty sure it is.
But that makes sense, because Lavrion was the byproduct of the silver mining.
Like copper for Cyprus, basically.
Yes, yeah, exactly.
But we have, I think, one copper nail that fingerprints with Lavrion as well, but there's something weird there.
The problem is, we, as Lena said, we can't test, even though we have the nails in the hole, and they're all on that particular plan. Each one of them that we drilled is nothing but a hole of concretion. Whereas all the nails in the nail sack, they have still metallic copper in them. But that's only a handful or a bunch. So.
But it's better than nothing.
Right, that's right.
And they were probably there to be used on the ship in case of emergency. As I think you all know, most of the hull is, if we go with Nelly Lipschitz's analyses, and she has analyzed over 400 wood samples. Every strake has been sampled, even whether the scarfs, you know, the front of the scarf and after the scarf. She says that the hull is Pinus brutia. There is some Cedrus Libani, cedar of Lebanon, for one of the frames is Cedrus Libani, and the...
Is that this one, Lena, 25?
Yeah. Not that one, only the top, dead out gray finger. Not that section. That's Pinus brutia, that section.
And then also the knee for the stern post is Cedrus Libani.
Yeah.
I think we have one frame at least that's poplar. It's interesting that poplar is being used.
That's 49.
And I don't think we have an oak frame.
Yeah, we do. Number 37.
37.
It's Quercus
Coquifera. And the steering oar, which we have the starboard steering oar, which Dan Davis is going to be studying, we hope, more fully. That is a pine. There have been some pieces of wood found in the big concretion that are of ash, which we'd like to see be part of the tiller. Definitely it's not the loom for the steering, or we don't have anything big enough. Then we have one piece, well actually two fragments, of what we think may be the yard. It's UM99. It'll be on the drawing, the front drawing there. It's down close to the starboard side, the starboard portion of the hull. It has a copper band around it, which turns into double rings. There are two pieces. It is made of ash. The second piece, which Mr. Steffi forgot about in the publication, I was poking around in it couple of years ago and found that it has a mortise and a tenon in it. And this could be evidence to attach a fair lead on the top of the yard if indeed it is part of the yard. So that is quite exciting news, but...
it was found right beside a cauldron, copper cauldron, right next to it. So it's tucked in.
Now how does that work? A mortise and tenon to attach a fair lead, which would be a ring.
Well,
wooden. It's about wooden.
It'd be a wooden fairly, so it'd have, it would have a little arch in it, like this.
Yes.
So it would be attached more as a tenon on the other side.
And the fragment isn't big enough to have the second tenon, if indeed for us a second.
So it's just the what would you call it, the trace of the whatever the attached part was, or is that all?
We don't have the attached part. We just have the attachment for something.
So. The mortise is cut, there's a tenon in it.
The mortise is cut down into the oval,
the ash
into the piece of ash. It happens that it's right at the break. And the mortise goes down about that far, and there is a fragment of the tenon which is shaped with the characteristic bottom end like this in it. And there's half a peg hole for attaching into something.
Into the
fair lead of whatever may have been there.
Would you think, just put on the side, would you think that, is that going to take pressure? It's going to take pressure, right?
Not that much.
Not much?
No, because the pressure is diverted downward.
Yeah.
Right, so if you get
a line
over the yard, it's always going to be pulling it down anyway.
Yes, it is, but my point is that up and down, up and down, up and down, up and down, over
some
fair lead.
Yeah, there's going to be some. That's why you do mortise and tenon.
Yeah.
Oh, okay, so you can replace it.
Mm-hmm.
Interesting idea.
And the two rings, instead of having a parrel that would hold the yarn to the mast, you'd have two rings that spring off of that fitting.
Yeah, amazing.
That would simply be roped around the mast. So in other words, you don't have the leather gasket that they use on K2 and
Liberty.
You have something a bit more fixed.
Maybe it's time to move on to another topic.
What other ones do we want to discuss in here? Because we've got navigation, sailing, we've covered the bulkhead, we've covered the repairs and the final achieving, covered the heightening of the ship. But Dan, I think maybe if you could tell us some things about what you have been working with Glafos, with Kyrenia
yeah.
too, but it's
I made some handouts, I'll pass those around. Unfortunately, I don't have enough for everybody. I want to blame my student for the copying snafu, but I think I'll blame my student for it. I'm not saying it was his fault, but it was his fault.
Can you send
it on to me
and we have a screen?
I could,
yeah. Where's our screen? We don't have a screen.
This has, I threw a little bit of everything into this handout going around.
We can get